Yes, as we've said before, all these sessions are going to be recorded. So if you don't want your face on the internet, don't put your camera on, but our breakout rooms will not be recorded. So if you want to put your cameras on then, feel free to. That is very much encouraged. Okay, so I think that was enough time. Let's get moving on with the session. So, and again, we also set up Discord in session zero. So if you need help with setting that up, you can ask your mentors during the breakout rooms. We're just gonna move on to our session content. So we're gonna be getting our notebook ready, getting used to using Trinket. We're gonna be using processing, which we're going to have set up and draw. We're going to be drawing some shapes, and we're going to learn how to print text. We're going to be learning about variables. We're going to be learning about operators, and we're going to learn about the special mouse position variables. All right, so let's get started with this. So here's the basics. Reminder on getting set up. Again, we did this in session zero. If you need help with this, ask your mentors in the breakout rooms. So you're gonna log in at trinket.io. I'm gonna create a new Trinket in Python. And the first thing you're gonna wanna do when you're writing new code is type the line from processing import star. Generally, whenever you type star, that's gonna mean import everything. So that's gonna be importing everything from the processing library, which we're gonna be using a lot in these sessions for drawing shapes and doing all sorts. So you have Trinket open right now. This would be a good place to start. Just try writing out from processing import star. Very important. That's how we're going to start most of our code. Okay. For now, all of our code is going to go inside the setup function. So everything inside the setup function is going to run once you start your program. So we're going to have code in here. We're going to have line def set up with brackets and then a colon, and then we're going to have a single tab and then write all our code. That's kind of the syntax for functions in Python. So our setup function is going to look a little something like this. And the other important function we're going to have is going to be the draw function, which is different from the setup function because everything that you put in the draw function will loop over and over again until you close the program. If you have code that you want to update as you're running the program, you're going to put that in the draw function instead of set. And again, the syntax is pretty much the same as it was for setup. Don't worry, you don't need to have this all memorized right away. We will be going over this later, and you can ask your mentors about it. If you have setup and you have draw, you have to include run at the very end to visualize your drawings and run your code. So that's the most important thing. See, if you don't have run, it's not going to run anything. Okay, so that's setup, run, setup, draw, and run. Three very important functions. Another important function that we're going to use mostly for debugging is going to be print. So if you use the function print, you're going to have brackets and then some words in between double quotes, and it'll print whatever you wrote in between those quotes to the screen. So this is going to be a useful tool for debugging and seeing what's going on in your program. And another thing important that we should go over is comments. So anything after the pound signal is ignored by the code, like the computer won't see it, it won't compile that. So you can just write notes into your code so that like when you're reading it, you can know what's going on. Putting comments in your code is generally considered very good practice, makes it more readable, makes it so that you can tell what your code is actually doing. So here we have a print statement, hello world. And then we put a comment, this prints hello world, in case you weren't sure what your program was supposed to be doing. Okay, so for drawing things with processing, we need to define a space to work in. And to do that, we use the size function. So the size function will define the dimensions of the display window. So the parameters it takes are width and height. So if we wanted to make a display window that is 600 units wide and 800 tall, we would write it like this in the setup function, with size 600, 800. And so most functions will have arguments like this, where it'll take multiple arguments, and you need to put both of the parameters into that function. Okay, so that'll create our window. And to create things in the window, one of the things we can create is a rectangle. So function for a rectangle is just called rect, and it takes four parameters. It'll take the x coordinate of the top left corner, the y coordinate of the top left corner, the width of the rectangle, and the height of the rectangle. So you're drawing a rectangle, you'll place the left corner first, and then you'll draw the width and height out from there. And how the coordinate system works in processing is the top left corner is the origin. So it's kind of opposite to how like the Cartesian plane works normally, but if we're going to the right, we'll be increasing, and if we're going down, it'll be increasing height. So just keep that in mind. Okay. And another shape we can make is an ellipse. So the x and y coordinate will be at the center of the ellipse, and then we can change the width and the height of the ellipse. And if we want to make a circle, we can just create an ellipse with the same width. So now, time for a quick question to see if you all were paying attention. So hope you all have top hat ready. Janine, do we have the quick questions ready?
Yep, it's just been assigned.
All right. Great.
Great. If you haven't answered yet, here it is on the screen.
Second, make sure you get your answers in for the two people who haven't already. Okay, so one of you got the correct answer. Just a reminder, the x and y coordinates for an ellipse are going to be in the center of the ellipse. So for the ellipse to be touching the top left edges, the center point of the ellipse would have to be at 50-50. And since D is going to be the diameter of the ellipse, for it to have a radius of 50, it's going to have a diameter of 100. So congratulations to the one person who got this question correct. And back to the presentation. Okay, moving on. So, we can set our background to a color once we've created like the window for our drawings to be in. And our backgrounds are either on an RGB scale or a gray scale. So, all of the values are between 0 and 255. So RGB, red amount, green amount, and blue amount, whereas grayscale is just a scale from 0 to 225, with 0 being all black and 255 being all white. We can change the color of a shape by using fill and stroke. So fill will select the color to fill inside all the shapes that you write after that. Or you can, you have the option to create no fill, and stroke will just create the border around the outside of the shape. We can make the border a different color and we can make inside a different color by using stroke and fill. So here's an example where we make a rectangle and stroke, we set it to all red, so it'll have a red border, and we set fill to all green, so it'll have all green fill. And generally, when we use background, it'll just paint the entire window. But generally, we put that before we draw anything else, so that it won't draw the background over top of anything else we've already drawn. And when we give fill a color, it will apply that to anything we draw after. Same thing with stroke. So if we wanted to keep the stroke black for the whole time, we don't have to change that for every single drawing we make, just when we want to make the fill or the stroke a different color. Okay, and now onto our first exercise. So we're gonna draw the Calgary Tower. It'll look a little something like this. We use setup to define the color, and we make four rectangles and make them all different sizes. Give you a chance to experiment, give you a couple minutes in breakout rooms to work through this with your mentors. Janine, do we have the breakout room set up?
Yes. You should get an invitation to enter your breakout room now.
I think we will do we want to do 20 minutes for this breakout room?
Sure, that sounds good.
Okay. All right, we'll call you back in 20 minutes. And I'll get the slideshow back on the road. I hope you were able to create something resembling a tower or a couple rectangles or something. These exercises are important. Don't worry about like submitting these or having them be perfect. We're just kind of getting used to the Trinket programming environment and using processing. There's just a couple things to just kind of get comfortable with coding. Anyway. Moving on, the next thing we're going to talk about is variables. So a variable is an object that stores a value. So basically, you give it a name and you have it contain a value. So each value has a different type. There are multiple different variable types, which we will go over quickly. First type we're going to learn about is an integer. An integer is an integer. It's a whole number. It has no decimals. It can include positive and negative numbers and zero. Syntax is written like this. Say we want to have a variable called age, and we want to set that age to 19 or 101 or negative 2. You can set it to any of those numbers, and then it'll be an integer type. The next type we have is float. Floats are similar to integers, but we can use decimals now. Decimals, very cool. Let's say we wanted to have a variable called salary. We would define that variable like this. So that's integers and floats. Another thing that's cool about Python is we don't have to worry about defining the variable type before we set the variable. It'll just set it automatically. So like here, if we type in a decimal number, it will automatically define that as a float. And if we have it set as a float initially, we can later, it'll stay afloat, even if we set that to like negative 10.0, like that could be an int, but since it has the 0.0, it will be afloat. And the next type we're going to go over is strings. So strings are just text. We kind of went over this in the print function. Print function will take an argument that is a string. So the string will always be in between double quotes or single quotes. There's a few minor differences between the syntax of double quotes and single quotes that you don't really need to worry about right now. We will primarily be using double quotes for the purposes of this course. So use double quotes for all your string needs. You can type ignite between double quotes, or U of C between double quotes, or 4th Street between double quotes. And all of those will be strings. And so, kind of the benefits of using a variable is that we can access the value of the variable from other places in our code. We want to define a variable for height, and then we want to print the height later and just put print height instead of print 10 every single time. Okay, now for another trick, not trick question, it's not a trick. We taught you about this. Quick question, what type of value are we assigning to this variable? I'll let Janine share this. Okay, it looks like everyone's answered this question. Ooh, seeing a lot of variance in our answers. For all of you who answered C, you're correct. It is a string. You'll notice that the variable is assigned between double quotes. If it's between double quotes, that means it will be a string. If we're defining a float or an integer, we do not include the double quote. All right, great job to everyone who got that right. Moving back on to the slides. Okay, and now we're gonna have another exercise using variables. So part one of this exercise, we will be starting by creating snowmen. You can copy this code exactly. I will even paste it into the chat so you can get it from there. And that will create these two snowmen. And then the next part of the exercise is you're gonna move both of the snowmen 50 pixels right and 50 pixels down. All right. So I'll give you about 10 minutes to work on this one. Be a bit shorter than our last exercise. But we'll go back into our breakout rooms. And just copy the code for everyone's use. I don't think we need that much time for this exercise. And probably close the breakout room chat. Well, I said 10 minutes, so that'd be 12, 58.
Sounds good.
Okay, it looks like we had someone just join.
Yeah, I'm gonna assign them to a breakout room.
Great.
Hi.
Hey.
Hello.
Is everything okay?
Yeah, everything is good. I have one mentee and I'm just showing her the code. I got invited back to the main room.
Oh, I might have done that by accident. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. That's all good. I'll go back then.
Yeah, sorry about that. It was a mistake. Still have a couple more minutes. Okay, I think we can close the breakout rooms soon in like 1 minute.
I'll just select close rooms now though, because it gives them 60 seconds still to
okay. Yeah. Wrap. Okay. Getting back to the presentation. Hope that snowman exercise wasn't too bad. Kind of the whole point of this was to show how using variables can make writing code so much easier. Like for example, moving this snowman, we have to edit every single X and Y coordinates. Whereas if we make all of X and Y coordinates relative to the X and Y coordinates of the first snowball, we can just edit these ones to move it 50 left and 50 down. 50 right and 50 down, sorry. And then we can move that snowman. Anyway, that's kind of the point of that exercise. Next thing we're gonna learn about is operators. It's not like a phone operator. Operator as in arithmetic operators. Basically, we can make programs do math. We can use addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. Hopefully you've learned about all these already. We'll also, another common one that we might use is called modulo or modulus. That's the percent symbol, and it basically will take the remainder of whatever you're dividing. So for example, 5 modulo 2 will be the remainder that you get after you divide 5 by 2. So in this case, it will be 1. And if you did, for example, 12 modulo 3, that would be 0. You get no remainder after dividing 12 by 3. That's another useful arithmetic operator. So now for our last quick question of the session, how can we define these parameters so that a circle defined within ellipse with these parameters will stay at the top left corner of the screen with any diameter? I'll let Janine share this question. We'll get our answers in. All right, looks like most of you got the right answer for this one. Great job. So we make the x position half of the diameter, then the center of the circle will always be the radius length away from the top left corner. So it will always stay in the same position relative to the top left corner. That's how we can use arithmetic operators to kind of scale our variables relative to a certain position. All right, very cool. Moving on, the last thing we're going to talk about in this session is our special mouse variable. We can use the variables mouse x and mouse y to access the position of our mouse's x and y coordinates. We don't have to assign a variable to these variables. The program will do this automatically. It'll automatically find the position of your mouse and track a variable to where it is. So, we want to make a program where we make a rectangle follow our mouse around. This is how we would do it. We would set the x and y position of our rectangle to mouse x and mouse y so that it'll always be in the same position as our mouse. Okay, and one last thing I wanted to go over this session that we didn't quite get a chance to touch on last session is how to submit your code. There's a certain way we got to do this in Trinket. Move it out of the way. So I'll open this up. Let's say I wanted to submit my beautiful Calgary Tower exercise to get marked. So what we would do is we want to submit a link for our code. And what we got to do, this isn't the right menu. We got a view on Trinket.io. We'll pull up a different window, and that'll allow us to put interactive Python anywhere on the web. That'll give us a few different menu options, which includes this little pull-down bar, which will give us the options to either send our code as an email, have it as a link, embed it in a different window, or download it. We want to get this as a link. So we'll code and output side by side. And this will kind of let us show how we want to have our link. Then we can copy this. Okay. Bit of technical difficulties with that. That's okay. Get the link. Well, this is a slight problem. Let me just make sure I save my code. And then this will give us the option to create a link. should be saved. This should be saved. Yep. Neon trinkets. Okay. Well, it appears that it won't let me get a link for this code. That's okay. We'll have that figured out for the next session. For now, we're going to move on to our end of session exercises. So, I'm going to get back to the slideshow. We got a few different exercises. The first ones are for bug busters, which is for if you've never touched code before. We're going to have two exercises. Details for these in the breakout rooms. The first one is to create a square that will change from black to white as you move your mouse across the screen. And the other one is to create a couple of rectangles that will follow your mouse as shown. And we have a different exercise for Pythonic Lava. One of them is to create a bunch of circles that follow your mouse around. And the other one is to create a rectangle that will follow the position of your mouse and also change color as you move it around the screen. So that's a slightly more difficult exercise. And then we have these two just for fun. If you get through those exercises. And, oh, another thing I wanted to mention is on the Shield Ignite website, I will go to that now. On this website, you want to submit your exercises, you just go into student links, and then you will submit them to either Bugbusters or Pythonic Lava. So you'll click on that and submit it to this form. Is there a way you can get a link for this presentation? Yes, I'm not sure if it's up yet, but the links for these presentations should also be up on the Shield Ignite website. So if you go to Ignite Beginner, because these are the beginner sessions, you'll find contents for session zero and session one. You can just go here and click View the Slides. And here's the slides for this whole session. So I'll let you go into breakout rooms for the rest of the session to work on those exercises with your mentors. Okay, I guess we'll just bring them back at 1:30.
Sounds good.
I can't believe I still couldn't get the submissions for Trinket because I had a problem with that last session too, where it has like the button for share and when you click it, it doesn't do anything.
Yeah, I wonder what the problem is because like, I don't know. I haven't played around with Trinket too much, so I'm not sure if it's like a Trinket problem or if it's just the project size.
shouldn't matter. Just feeling kind of upset about that because I was messing around with Trinket a bunch last night because in session zero, I couldn't get it working either. And I figured out that if you open it in trinket.io, it'll have the menu where you can get the link. And then I was just like, oh, okay, that's how I'll show it in the next session. And it still doesn't actually let you get the link. So
it doesn't let you? Like, even if you just click on one of their example projects and try to share it?
Try with the example projects, but
that's so weird.
I was running into the same problem.
Weird.
Yeah, it says copy the link below to share your code and then doesn't give you a link.
That's weird. Mine doesn't do that.
Wait, does yours actually show the link?
Yeah, mine shows a link and then there's a button to like
guys, my battery just died and I'm not in my breaking room right now. Can you put me back in the breaking room?
Yeah.
It was 7.
A 7. Okay.
Thank you.
Done. Let me see. Are you like logged in when you go on Trinket.io? Because like it's just attached to my like Gmail. I wonder if you have to have like an account or something.
Yeah, I'm on my account.
Oh, that's so weird.
It lets me like view like the different examples I have saved. Just won't let me create a link.
Weird.
Oh well, hopefully next session I can figure out what's wrong. Do another submission demo.
Yeah, I wonder if maybe like Fanny or Logan can make like a little demo video showing how to do it to share. That way in case it's not working next time.
Yeah. So like on yours, like when you click share, does it like come up with the options? Like just like the button in like the top right corner?
Yeah, so when I click share, there's email, link, publish, download.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, I guess at least it's just a me problem. That's still not great. Maybe I'll like make a new account with like my UFC email. I just use my regular email for that.
I mean, I just use my Gmail for it, so I don't know if that would matter.
Yeah, I don't think it should. It's very weird. Caitlin. Literally all of the other options work. It literally just won't create a link.
Yeah, that's really weird.
I mean, I can go to the embed your code option and copy the little link it has in the like within the HTML code. Like that seems very counterintuitive.
Yeah, and
that's. I feel like I should be able to do it easier than that.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe just at like the end of the session, we could do a quick little thing where you go over the submission demo, just because it wasn't working when I was doing it.
Yeah, we can do that. I don't have any demo projects, but I can just open one that they have.
You don't need to have it on like an actual project. You can just literally just have Hello World and just show how you create the link.
Oh, okay, awesome. Yeah, I can do that. We also have the end of session polls as well.
Oh yeah, should we bring them back a bit earlier to do that?
Yeah, I'll bring them back like maybe in 5 minutes.
Okay. Yeah, I think for the next session, we'll probably try to pace it a bit better because we usually want to leave a bit more time for these end of session exercises. But
yeah,
that's okay. We're still working things out.
Yeah.
I'm gonna close the rooms now.
Okay, sounds good. All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome back. I hope you were able to make some progress on those end of session exercise. And just a reminder that you have until next week's session to submit those to the Google form. So don't worry if you didn't get those done right away. We're just going to close out the session. Janine is going to show the submission demo that I wasn't able to. That was just technical difficulties on my end. So we're going to show that real quick, and then we're going to do our end of session poll.
All right, so here's a Trinket.io just blank project just to show you guys how to share. So when you click the share button here, you should have the link option. And then when you click it, there should be a link here that you can copy and paste and submit to the form. And for our end of session polls, we have two for you guys. There's no right answer, so don't worry about getting it right or wrong. It's just some feedback for us. All right, I think everyone answered, so I'll move on to the last poll of the day. So this is the last one. Again, it's just for some feedback, so answer however you'd like.
That was just to give us a bit of feedback. Looks like we have a couple questions here. So where do we put the link to submit it? That is actually something that still needs to be updated on the submission forms, because right now we have it with the format we had for the submissions for last semester. We haven't updated the submission forms yet, but when we do, we'll probably create an announcement in the Discord. As a reminder, also join the Discord so you can see such announcements such as that, and also ask your mentors questions outside of sessions. How can we know if we are in the Bugbusters or Pythonic Lava category? That would have been something you signed up for on the intake form. So if you have no coding experience whatsoever, you'll be in the Bugbusters category. If you have a little bit of coding experience, you'll be in the Pythonic Lava category. So is that it for questions for this session? Okay, well, if no one else has any more questions, I will leave it at that.
Wait, I have one more question.
Quick. Yes, what is that?
So I just tried to join the Discord link. Like, there's a link to join, yeah. And I said it was invalid invite, so I'm not sure that means.
Was it the same link we have on the Slack?
It's the one in the email that was sent, like, 9 days ago.
Yeah, the Discord link's only active for a few days, so I'll send a new one in the chat.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, use the link to Janine sent. And that goes for everyone who has not yet joined the Discord. Use that one.
Okay, I got it.
Do we have a Discord group chat with only your group and your mentor? Yes, but you need to go into the bot commands channel to join that group. So the instructions to do that are on the slides. I'll just show that quickly. It'll be on this slide. So you just follow these instructions to go like group set, Saturday, whichever group number you're in. That's how you join your private channel with just your mentor. Okay, do we have any other questions? Okay, well, if that is it, then I will let you go and I will see you all next Saturday. Mentors, could we all please stick around for a short debrief? Okay, I will pull up the debrief thing. Just go through all the questions, hopefully pretty quickly. Okay, here we go. Okay, question one, were your mentees engaged in the breakout room? And go through one by one. We can start with Payam, just because you're first on my screen. I can't hear you, you're muted.
I said, should I just tell you here or feel by myself? Feel the form.
Yeah, we usually discuss this as a group.
Mm-hmm. So my mentees, yeah, there were two of them, and they engage pretty much into any question.
Okay. Nice couple questions. Did your mentees struggle with review material? Did they have technical?
Yeah, they had technical difficulties. The main thing was because they didn't access to the slides. They didn't remember any of syntaxes. Like, we quickly perused through feel, stroke, and rect, and then exercise. And they had struggles to find which was the good syntax for feel, stroke, and anything else. And we didn't go back to show them once again after reading the exercise. So here, they had to take screenshots beforehand, and I suggest that we share syntaxes or the recorded methods that we are using in exercises in the description, or just quickly go back to the functions after reading the exercise. This is a suggestion. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. I think just to fix that for next time, probably make sure that all the mentees have access to the slides just for reference, so mm-hmm. that they are less likely to get stuck on syntax and those things.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then just a general question, why did you join Schillig Ignite?
Yeah, because to meet new people and gain experience in teaching, and mainly because new people see new people and new adventures, like, yeah.
Okay. Glad to hear it.
Thank you.
Okay, Brendan, you're next. So were your mentees engaged? Were there any difficulties?
Yeah, I'd say they're pretty engaged. I had